Good morning and welcome to Old West Church. My name is Sara and I have a few announcements for you today. So today's the third Sunday of Advent. So if you are at home alone, at your own home, you know, doing your own thing, joining us, like not in person, and you're like, I should light my candles. You'll like three candles this week for the three Sundays of Advent. So in terms of announcements, today we will be continuing our Advent Bible study, which is online. Yay! And if you need the Zoom link for that, just let me know and I can send it to you after the service. And then at 7:45 p.m., we'll be having our church conference. And church conference is like our big voting time of the year. And so we vote on budget and leadership. And so if you need the link for that, we're ready to send it to you. And you just, we have that ready for you. And then we also have a digital packet and that has all the information, everything we'll be voting on. So all of the business for the year, that's at our annual meeting. And then a couple of other announcements. Christmas Eve will be a hybrid. It'll be 6:30 p.m. Eastern. Both on Zoom. So if you're like, too cold or I'm out of town, you're welcome to join us via Zoom. Or if you're here in Boston, you're welcome to join us. We'll be doing this jointly with Union Church, which is on Columbus Ave. And so we'll be doing this in their chapel. And so if you would like to join us either in person or online, we'll be worshiping once again with Union Church. And then Christmas Sunday is December 26th. And it's literally the day after Christmas. And so many of us won't be here. We'll be traveling, including like our wonderful tech humans and Con Ed humans. And so it's a little difficult for us to put on the whole thing. And so we will be doing service completely on Zoom. So kind of doing a throwback to, I guess, like a couple of months ago. But so Christmas Sunday, all on Zoom. You can stay in your pajamas. Have hot chocolate and still be on time. It's the best thing. And then I think that's it. Monday and Tuesday are normal community dinner, fiber arts. You're always welcome to those. But I'll send also a little reminder again about Bible study and church conference at the end of the service. So I think that's it in terms of announcements. And so once again, I just want to say welcome. Whoever you are, however you're joining us, whatever you believe or don't believe, whether you remember to light your Advent candles or not, you are fully welcome in this space, and we're so glad you're here. Our practice at Old West is that whoever is leading a certain part of the service will read the italics, and then the community is invited to respond with the bold. So I invite you to join me in the call to worship. Receive the good news. God is doing a new thing. God's promises are fulfilled in the incarnation of Christ. They will lead us, love us, and they delight in us. Alleluia, alleluia, alleluia. Our first hymn is Come and Thou Long Expected Jesus, which is in the United Methodist hymnal, that blue book on page 196. It's only two verses, so we're going to sing both of them. I invite you to, if you're here IRL, you're welcome to stand or stay seated, whatever you're most comfortable with, but you're invited to sing out.
Come thou long expected. Alrighty, if you guys wouldn't mind joining me in our responsive reading this morning, just like before, I'll read the italics and you guys can join me in the bold. Be glad in the Lord always. Again, I say, be glad. Let your gentleness show in your treatment of all people. The Lord is near. Don't be anxious about anything. Rather, bring up all of your requests to God in your prayers and petitions, along with giving thanks. Then the peace of God that extends all understanding will keep your hearts and minds safe in Jesus.
Okay, so it's been our practice during Advent to, it's also our stewardship campaign, which is kind of like stewardship has a lot of ways you can think about it. Like old school church is like the fundraising campaign for the year. But for us, we think of giving and stewardship, not just like just money, but also like how we give and give in the community. And so our theme is for the sake of the city. And so during Advent, we're asking the oldest community to make a commitment to not just us, but to the community. And so we'd asked different people from the church life to make some time to take a video and tell us a little bit about what they're doing and making a commitment for in 2022. And so you're always, they're also like on the internet, so you're welcome to check it out there. But basically, as part of the giving campaign and the stewardship campaign, we're asking people to fill out a commitment card. And the commitment card can include money, but it also can include like, hey, I'm going to like work in the food forest, or I'm going to work for justice this way. And so it's kind of almost like a New Year's resolution in the way that you're going to give and commit to like seeking justice and mercy in the city. And so we've got Kate who has a video today. So I invite you to watch this and then we'll shift into the sermon. Blooper reel that I also made as a gift for my gratitude. I know I was holding back. There is a really great blooper reel that I might have made first before I made that video because it was really great. Okay, cool. So just a reminder, you can find that online. It's really easy. Just go to our website. We are continuing our sermon series called Minor Prophets, Major Good News. And so today we're reading from the prophet Zephaniah, Zephaniah 3, 14 through 20. Rejoice, daughter Zion, shout, Israel. Rejoice and exalt with all your heart, daughter Jerusalem. The Lord has removed your judgment. They have turned away your enemy. The Lord, the sovereign of Israel, is in your midst. You will no longer fear evil. On that day, it will be said to Jerusalem, don't fear Zion. Don't let your hands fall. The Lord, your God, is in your midst, a warrior bringing victory. They will create calm with their love. They will rejoice over you with singing. I will remove from you those worried about the appointed feasts. They have been a burden for her, a reproach. Watch what I am about to do with all of your oppressors at this time. I will deliver the hurting. I will gather the outcast. I will change their shame into praise and fame throughout all the earth. At that time, I will bring all of you back. At that time, I will gather you. I will give you fame and praise among all the neighboring peoples when I restore your possessions that you can see them, says the Lord. This is the word of God for you, the people of God. Thanks be to God. Zephaniah is a really, really short book. And so if you're like, I have never seen this in my Bible, it's probably because two pages were like stuck together and you just kept turning and you missed a whole book. It's a total of 3 chapters, which in fact can on most Bibles fit on 2 pages. And in the 3-year lectionary cycle, which is when some people way back in the day were like, we're going to take the Bible and try to like read all of it in churches in 3 years. Zephaniah only occurs twice in 3 years, which is not a lot. But at least it gets some coverage. Zephaniah is rarely covered. And so it's not shocking if it's not a book we're super familiar with. So up until this point, we read the end of chapter 1 and 2 have been rather doom and gloom, which is on brand for most prophets. In those previous chapters, though they're brief, it's full of some really hard truths for Israel. In the first chapter, judgment is pronounced. Destruction is foretold. The sound of the day of the Lord is bitter. It's going to be a day of fury, a day of distress and anxiety, a day of desolation and devastation, a day of darkness and gloominess. I mean, wow, that is depressing. It says that the coming day of the Lord is not one of gladness, but gloom. It's not one we should wait with eager anticipation, but anxiety and even fear. In chapter 2, we are told that there is some possibility that you could prevent this devastation from coming. It says, seek the Lord, all you humble of the land who practice God's justice. Seek righteousness, seek humility. Then, says the prophet, maybe, just maybe, you will be hidden on the day of the Lord's anger. So it still says that the day of the Lord will be one of anger, but that perhaps, maybe, just perhaps, you might be protected. It's not what I would say super reassuring, but I guess it's better than nothing. I mean, it's a flicker of hope, a slight chance at reversing the predicament, a sliver that it's not going to be complete anger, but there might be some acceptance that love might actually win over the law, that their wrongdoings will be washed away and justice will be reestablished. But it's just the tiniest of hopes, the barest hint. And this brings us to chapter 3. Chapter 3 picks up with this, the reiteration of the prophet's telling of doom, the foretelling of Israel's destruction. Political and religious leaders have been called out because they are corrupt, inept, and unjust. And then that's the first half. And then we get to today's reading, which presents a dramatic shift in tone and pronouncement. Rejoice, daughter Zion, and be glad. The divine moves from judgment to joy, from condemnation to restoration. No longer is the day of the divine one of doom, but it's one of delight. And it has one of my favorite images in scripture of God singing over creation.
God breathed life into creation at the beginning of it all, and now God is singing over them. That to me is one of my favorite images of all scripture. This day of the divine has been transformed. The spark of hope has been turned into a beacon. It's a new reality, for God is to be reconciled with their people, removing all the wrongdoings and evil deeds from among them. And why does this shift matter? Sure, it's nice that God is going to offer forgiveness and grace and love to the people. But why do we even have the beginning of Zephaniah if this was going to be the result? What's the purpose of these declarations, these earlier declarations of doom and destruction, if the result was always going to be reconciliation? Because, y'all, it wouldn't actually have the impact that it does. It wouldn't actually be reconciliation and restoration without that first initial pronouncement. We would not know the profound relief of this shift of our fortunes and our futures if we had not experienced the promise of utter annihilation just a few verses earlier. We wouldn't experience the divine's delight and the true joy of them singing over us and it would not be meaningful if we don't know what was first promised, the true weight and results of injustice and inaction in the face of corruption. Scholar and professor of biblical studies Jin Han points out, building on this gleam of hope, the prophet bursts into song of joy, songs of joy here in our reading today. And though the world is a total mess, though the people of God have failed, God will pull them through and still restore them, so that the day of the Lord is no longer one of annihilation, but of joy. Today's reading presents the people of Israel and us today with a total reversal of expected repercussions. Yes, injustice still exists, and yet grace abounds. And it brings with it joy, joy without limit. Often the third Sunday of Advent is one that we associate with joy. And here the prophet tells us quite uniquely about the delight of the divine, that they radiate joy, that they sing over their creation, much like the angels sung over the flocks by night while shepherds kept watch, of just like a mother whispered a lullaby to her firstborn child, wrapped in swaddling clothes and laid in a manger, for there was no room in the inn. It's the same joy radiating and being sung over something that we care so tenderly about. The coming of Christ takes this reversal of expectations to a new level. Jesus is the literal embodiment of the divine's overturning their judgment in favor of joy. It's the actual incarnation of shifting from destruction to reconciliation. God made flesh and dwelt among us. It is this realization that is so important that we get in Zephaniah and that we see fulfilled in the person of Christ. It's this realization that allows us to take up for ourselves the divine's joy. No longer is our reality one of injustice, but it's a new reality that we are called into and called to help co-create, to establish on hope and sung over by the divine. And it gives new meaning when we sing joy to the world. The Lord has come. For as Zephaniah tells us, from now on, that coming day of the Lord is actually good news for the people of Israel and for us today. I invite you now, as we enter into open space, to not only reflect on the divine, just perfect joy over each and every one of us as aspects of their creation, but also how we are called into that joy. And how we are called to help co-create a world that is filled with justice and filled with mercy and love, especially as we see in the changing of the seasons. Open space is a free form time where you're invited to engage in ways that are spiritually beneficial and uplifting for you. And so there's lots of ways you can do that. Over here with kind of like the purple cloth, there is candles and icons. You're welcome to light candles and reflect there if you'd like. To the right of that is a big sheet of paper where you're encouraged to write maybe something that gives you rest or renewal or revitalization, or collecting these for another project that will be, I would say, like teased later tonight at our church conference. So you show up, you find more out about it. Wow, it's so exciting. Wow, really set the stage for that. Well, you're welcome. Here, shift over here. There we have the beginning of a Stations of the Cross, starting with this white image and then going around the space that focuses on mental health. And underneath that is our communion setup. And so if you would like to take communion later in the service, we encourage you to get up during open space and prepare that. And so all of the communion setups are with grape juice. There's no alcohol, there is sugar, and it's a gluten-free rice cake. And if you're online and you're invited to prepare communion in your own home at this time, you're also invited to scan the QR code, and that will link you to not only online giving platforms, but also our prayer request platform. And we'll take those up for later in the service. We'll read them out loud. Here you can color with the Stations of the Cross that focuses on eco justice. And then the one over here, over kind of the table, focuses on refugee and immigrant justice. There's always books up here that you're invited to read. But during this time, we encourage you to get up, move around, and do what is spiritually like renewing for you. Welcome to Open Space.
Lo, how a rose air blooming. And that's on, I think, 216. Oh, I did it. 216 in your United Methodist hymnal. And so whether you're in person or online, you're invited to sing and sing out. And you're welcome to sing standing or seated, so whichever is most comfortable for you. Practice at Old West to say that you may be seated to begin our time of prayer by lifting up the mass shootings that have happened in just the last week in the United States. And so we lift up these cities knowing that they're just a small representation of the gun violence that happens in our nation. And of course, our prayer is that one day this practice is no longer one we have to do.
Lansing, Michigan, 1 killed and 3 injured.
Orlando, Florida, 5 injured.
Charlotte, North Carolina, 5 injured.
Beloit, Wisconsin, 1 killed, 5 injured.
Capitol Heights, Maryland, 4 injured.
Philadelphia, Pennsylvania, 4 injured.
Detroit, Michigan, 2 killed, 2 injured.
El Paso, Texas, 1 killed, 3 injured.
God, hear our prayer.
May continued gratitude and love envelop Pastor Sara as she faithfully navigates and leads with tenacity, vision, love, and grace. God, hear our prayer.
As we enter into our third week of Advent, may we faithfully and boldly hold joy in our grateful hearts.
God hear our prayer. Sing your joy over us and let us delight in you, Almighty God.
God hear our prayer. Bring an end to all systems of violence and institutions of injustice.
God hear our prayer. For Carmen, who continues to be in ICU.
God
hear our prayer.
For Jose Gabriel, who is not feeling well.
God
hear our prayer.
Giving thanks for our new mayor enacting electrification of the city's vehicles.
God hear our prayer. Keeping those who cannot attend worship in our care.
God hear our prayer. I pray for confidence in starting new things.
God hear our prayer. Prayers for all the families affected by the tornado in Kentucky and Tennessee. God, hear our prayer.
God of Mary and Sarah and Hagar, your children glorify you. We rejoice, we shout, we exalt, we rejoice over you with singing. We find hope and joy in all of your promises as we wait for the fulfillment of everything foretold. Your promises are our prayers. Deliver the hurting, gather the outcast, change our shame into praise, remove your judgment, create calm with your love, free all your people from their oppressors, fill the hungry with good things, empty us where we have embarrassments of riches, so that we may be filled anew with mercy and love, our fortunes restored. We await the day when all there is left to do is celebrate, because we find you are truly in our midst. O come, Emmanuel, deliver us from evil, guide us in your holy ways, keep us patient in the waiting. Amen.
Our practice to shift from prayers of the community to prayers around the communion table. And so I invite you to join me. I'll be reading the italics and I encourage you to respond with a bold. We cry out to you, our Creator, come to us quickly. Listen to our voice when we cry out to you. Let our prayers come before you like incense, and let our uplifted hearts be like an offering. Our hopes are in you, our Redeemer. We take refuge in you, our Sustainer. Holy, mighty, immortal one, from the setting of the sun to its rising, your name is praised throughout all the earth. From rocks and trees to birds and seas, from sanctuaries to living rooms, your name is known and your name is praised. And so from our homes and in our hearts, we praise and bless your holy name, your mighty works, and your promised redemption as we add our voices to the hosts of heaven and the angels above the shepherds in their ceaseless praise, joining their unending song, saying, Santo, 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 mi corazón te adora, mi corazón te sabe decir, Santo eres Dios. Truly you are holy, love divine. And you cherish and sing over us, your beloved creation. You love us so much that you sent your child to be in our midst, to teach us to become the beloved community. And it was into the midst of turmoil and uncertainty, fear and anxiety, that Christ took time showing us how to create community, calling each follower by name to be healed, renewed, and transformed. On the night of Jesus's arrest and execution, he took time once again, gathering some of his friends around a simple meal at a simple table. That night, he took some bread, he blessed it, and he broke it, and he gave it to those gathered, saying, take, eat. When the meal was over, Jesus took a cup, and doing the same, said, as often as you drink of this, remember me. And because we find ourselves, like those first disciples, in desperate need of beloved community, of God's justice, Christ's mercy, and the intervention and inspiration of the Holy Spirit, we remind ourselves of God's mighty acts and ongoing love as we proclaim the mystery of faith. Christ, you died, are risen, and will come again. We await your kingdom come on earth when your peace and justice will reign. Now is the point of the service that's called the epiclesis, and this is a fancy church word that simply means the blessing of the communion elements. And here at Old West, we believe quite firmly that it's not just the minister that blesses the communion elements, but each and every one of us, because we believe that we make up the priest of all believers, that each and every one of us has different gifts and graces that we are given by God to serve the community. And so in that serving, you're ministering to the world for the sake of the city and for the sake of the church in the world. And so it's not just me blessing, but each of you as well. And so I invite each of you to raise your hands and your hearts and bless the communion elements with me. Holy, mighty, immortal God,
despite our fears and anxieties, despite our failings, you are here. You always love us, always are with us, and always sing over us, singing and calling us back to you, to be in communion with you, and to become your blessed, beloved community. You call out to us to be in relationship with you, our creator, redeemer, and sustainer. And you call out to us to bring good news to the poor, to bind up the brokenhearted, proclaim release for the captives, liberation for the prisoners, and time of your favor. And though we may be weary of the work, we know your help is always on the way, and holy is your name. For you sent your child and you sent your spirit to be our teacher and our guide. So we pray, send your spirit once again to be in our midst, to be in our homes and on the gifts before us, so that this bread might be like your heart broken for the world, and this cup like your love poured out for the healing of the nations. May these gifts nourish us with grace and hope. Yet we pray, keep us hungry for the work until your kingdom come, your will be done for all creation. We pray this boldly, for we are your children, your beloved ones. Continue to teach us, feed us, inspire and guide us, and bring us into glory. Amen. And it's in the spirit of our sibling Christ that we are bold to pray these words. Eternal Spirit, earth maker, pain bearer, life giver, source of all that is and that shall be, divine parent of us all, loving God in whom is heaven, the hallowing of your name echo through the universe. The way of your justice be followed by the peoples of the world. Your heavenly will be done by all created beings. Your commonwealth of peace and freedom sustain our hope and come on earth. With the bread we need for today, feed us. In the hurts we absorb from one another, forgive us. In times of temptation and testing, strengthen us. From trials too great to endure, spare us. From the grip of all that is evil, free us. For you reign in the glory of the power that is love, now and forever. Amen. I invite you now, if you're taking communion, to take your rice cake or whatever you're using and to break a piece off. This is called the fraction. And like you are holding what was once a larger piece and you've got a smaller one now. So you are a small part of the body of Christ. And this shouldn't discourage us. It should encourage us because it means we don't do this alone. We don't serve by ourselves. We don't serve in isolation, but we serve interconnected with the world around us. And so if you're in person, I invite you to serve yourself. Take your mask down really quickly and then put it right back up. And if you're online and with others, you're invited to serve them as well if they'd like it. Our final hymn is Away in a Manger. And we'll sing all three verses, and it's on page 217 in your United Methodist hymnal. It'll also be on the screen. So don't worry if you're like, I think I know the tune, but maybe not all the words, or that there were three verses, they'll all be on the screen. So I invite you, you're welcome to stay seated or to stand, whichever is most comfortable for you.
Away in a manger, no crib for a bed,
the little Lord Jesus
lay down his sweet head. The stars in the sky look down where he lay, the little Lord Jesus asleep on the hay. The cattle are lowing, the baby awakes, but little Lord Jesus no crying he makes. I love thee, Lord Jesus, look down from the sky and stay by my cradle till morning is nigh. Be near me, Lord Jesus, I ask thee to stay close by me forever and love me, I pray. Bless all the dear children in thy tender care and fill
Old West here, we have a practice when we do the benediction. As you can see, it ends in three alleluias. The first alleluia is for yourself, the individual. The second alleluia is for the church. So since we're expanding our circle, we get a little bit louder. And then the last alleluia is for the world. So we say it just about as loud as we can. So with each alleluia, get a little bit louder. I invite you guys to join me in the bold. Receive the good news. God is with us. Salvation is at hand. Go forth with the good news of Christ's promised coming, bringing peace to all you meet. Alleluia, alleluia, alleluia.